subject, Jesus, that's my King. Jesus, that's my King. Zechariah 9 and 9 is the prophetic utterance of Christ Jesus, looked at as being King. We understand in reading this that Jesus had just finished his ministry. And by this triumphal entry into Jerusalem, he rides in. Zechariah's statement, of course, was but one of many reminders that Jesus is God's great King, as well as his great prophet and his great priest. Think about those things that he is looked at as being great King, great prophet, and great priest. And even as we think about the titles of our God, we have to understand that it is true that he was born in a stable. But in Matthew 2 and verse number 2, we find that the wise men, they came and they asked, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews?" King Jesus, we understand as great King, great prophet, and great high priest. As the wise men realized that they were not just coming to visit a prophet. There are those that look at Christ as just being another prophet. But remember, God says he is my great King, my great prophet, and my great priest. And if you will, look and see how he humbled himself. Born in a stable, but then he was King. His kingdom, we have to understand that as Jesus walked the length and the breadth of this world, that he walked with on his mind the affairs of the kingdom. He always had his kingdom on his mind. Even though it may not have looked like it, because he lived such a humble life. But he had much to say always about his. And so as we look at this today, there are those such as the disciples who understood exactly who Jesus was. They understood that his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, that they had to lay out the red carpet. And in laying out the red carpet, there were those that felt that Jesus should not have gotten the recognition that he so deserved. Just like today we have haters, and back then in biblical days, there were those that thought they were more religious than Christ himself was. And so it was, according to Luke 19 and 40, it tells us about the Pharisees. The Pharisees had the audacity, amen, to talk to Jesus because they were thought that this procession or this coronation that Jesus had experienced on his way into Jerusalem was highly improper. They thought that it was unnecessary. They thought, amen, that he did not deserve the accolade that they were giving unto Jesus. And so they have the nerve to tell Jesus, "Why don't you take the time and then rebuke your disciples? Because the disciples are looking at you as if you are our King." Amen. And so they understood, and Jesus said these words. He said, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, then the stones or the rocks will immediately cry out for them. Y'all don't hear me. And so we are understanding today that this, God help me, this prophet and this King and then this priest, amen, was looked at as just being another prophet. He was not looked at as being, amen, the King of glory, of God wrapped up in flesh and being the Savior of the world. And what Jesus had was saying unto them was that God's a plan for the world is bound up in his promise of a king that would come. A king that would be able to solve the problems of our sick and confused world. And understand the procession or the coronation that Jesus had experienced more than 2,000 years ago. It was a pre-coronation. It was a pre-time of recognizing Christ as king. They thought that as he would come, that he would be the savior and the deliverer for all of the Jews. And even though more than 2,000 years ago, this helps us to understand, amen, that Jesus Christ the King, that he came down to earth. But since he came down to earth, it helps us to realize that he would not rule then. And they couldn't understand why, if it was prophesied that Christ would come, he would not reign right then and there. They will not realize that Christ himself had a higher calling or a greater purpose, amen, that God had bestowed upon him. That he would not just become the king and the savior of the Jews, but for the Gentiles alike. God's plan for the ages revolve around his king. And he was promised to the Jews while the 12 tribes, amen, were on the way from Egypt. But then in Numbers 24 and 17 through 19, it reads these words, that there shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel. Out of Jacob shall come he that shall have dominion. And that word scepter there simply means a staff. And the staff happens to be a symbol of a ruler's power and authority. Can you imagine in your sanctified imaginations that Jesus Christ the King, as he comes to Jerusalem riding on an ass or riding on the coat of one, that he is coming with reigning power and reigning. So he realized, thy kingdom come, thy kingdom come. And whenever you read these scriptures, you understand that Christ happens to be the kingdom coming to earth. So during the centuries, we'd understand that this promise, it was repeated, that Christ would come and then reign as king. Amen. But there really wasn't the revelation that they wanted, amen, they could not understand or they could not receive. That the great king to come would have, listen here, an everlasting kingdom. Somebody holler, everlasting kingdom. Say it again with me, everlasting kingdom. That he would rule not only over the Jews, I like this, y'all, but he would also rule and reign and have dominion over the Gentiles. God help me here, because none of us in this room today, I believe, were born Jews. So we are a part of the Gentile nation. And so thank God that when he sent the king, that it just wasn't for the Jews, amen, but it was for all of the Gentiles. That he would not just reign and rule and have dominion for the Jews, but hear me, he looked down through the telescope of time and saw you and me, amen. And when he came, he said, I came for everybody. John 3:16 always goes along and backs it up. For God so loved the world. I like this, y'all. Y'all better help me here. Amen. That he gave his only begotten son. I like this part because it does not exclude anybody, but it includes everybody. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish. Will y'all help me here? But shall have. This is the recognition of someone that is not facing death. This is not the entry. This is not the entry of someone that is born in a stable. That's not the entry, amen, of someone that's meek and lonely. This happens to be the entry because remember now, the palm has to do, amen, with victory. Yeah. curse you with the same tongue. I can't get no help in here. Because the triumphal entry of Jesus as he comes into Jerusalem, and they have the audacity to lay down the palms, because within themselves they thought that their king, Jesus, for the Jews, was coming. Can I get some help in here today? And so they laid them down, and here comes Jesus as they threw their coat, amen, over the coat, amen, over the ass, and Jesus sits on there, not really looking like a king.
Right.
Yeah. Not riding on a beast. That he's not coming in on a chariot and the wheels are blazing. It does not look like the entry or the reception. And why is it that after all of these years and we've seen the rise and the fall of kingdom, that it happens to be this coronation that everybody remembers? Why is it that this is the one that we celebrate every year? Why is it that those that don't normally come to church Sunday after Sunday, is something about Easter that they feel the need to celebrate? You might think that it has to do with new clothes and all of that type of stuff. I don't believe that's some of it, but it's not all of it. I believe that God has placed a measure of faith in every man, woman, and boy and girl. And if they happen to show up on Easter unknowingly, really why they came, that's okay, because God put something in them that would get them here on Easter Sunday. You better slap somebody upside the head and say, I know that's right. It represents victory all over the world. At one time, amen, there was not an existence on the place of the earth that did not have palm trees. It's something about palm trees, amen, that we really don't understand, because even when the storms of life are raging, and even when there are great hurricanes and floods and the winds may blow over 150 miles per hour, you can see the palm tree. The palm tree is still standing. It rocks a little bit. Hallelujah. And the thing about the palm tree, amen, that it's up high and is elevated above all others. As to say that I am the toughest, I'm the strongest, that there's something about me that other trees that are among me don't possess. And so they laid these things down, and as he's coming, the question is, who was the king that Jesus was really saying that his kingdom had already begun? And even though it is an unseen kingdom, you have to realize that his kingdom is very, very real. Can I get two witnesses in here today that can understand that his kingdom is very, very real? And even though it may not seem that his kingdom is an operative kingdom, or that his kingdom is in existence today, but you have to grab hold and know, amen, that it is an unseen kingdom. Yes, we thank God today for everybody that can discern his lordship and then respond to his will. Everybody that can discern his lordship and then respond. I feel like preaching, y'all can tell, don't you? And then respond to his will. You have to understand that you are now a part of the kingdom. Everybody that's in this room today that knows how and has accepted him into your life and being not just your Savior, but accepting him as being Assurance.